as I lay me down. Heaven, hear me now. I'm lost without a cause. After giving it my all, winter storms have come and darkened my sun. After all that I've been through, who on earth can I turn to? I look to you. I look to you. After all my strength is gone, in you I can be strong. I look to you. Searching for that open door. And every road that I've taken led to my regret. And I don't know if I'm gonna make it. Nothing to do but lift my head. I look to you. I look to you.
to stand now as we join in singing the great hymn of the church. There's a land beyond the river.
There's a land beyond the river.
Or death, we are in the hands of the Lord. Christ lived and died and lives again to establish his lordship over dead and living. Be seated for prayer. Shall we bow our hearts in prayer? Our loving, merciful Heavenly Father, the creator of life, the creator of the universe, in you, dear God, we live and we move and we have our being. Without you, we are nothing. We come this morning in your most holy presence to celebrate the life of one that lived for you, lived to serve you, lived to serve our fellow brothers and sisters, and live a life that is secretly dedicated to you. We come with mixed feelings. But as we gather, dear God, help us not to mourn or to weep as people who have no hope. For you are the Redeemer of our life. You have purchased us with your precious blood. We are not your home. We are not our home. We belong to you. So as we go through this service of thanksgiving, thanksgiving for the life of our dear sister, Norma, a woman of God, one who truly loved our brothers and our sisters, but most of all, one who truly loved the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you for her life. You gave life, and you gave life. And as a church, as a people of God, we say, blessed be the name of the Lord. We pray the presence of your Holy Spirit upon us now. And that, Father, everything that is being done this day, nothing will be done to bring praise and glory to men, but that all will be done to lift up your mighty name, to worship you in the beauty of holiness, and to praise you, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. As we come to say farewell to our sister, help us, Lord, that all of us here this morning will look at ourselves one more time, looking our lives and see. And then we shall present our bodies to you as living sacrifice, to worship you, to adore you, and to lift up your mighty name. For everyone who shall bring you, may he thus say to God, not as men deserve, but as God deserves. Even we remember the Father. My dear brother Roy and Chris, breathe upon them now with the Lord. Fill them with life. Remind them that if there is ever a time that they need Jesus Christ, the time is now. So, Spirit of the Living God, touch their hearts, their soul, their mind, and all the friends and relatives of our dear sister. May we be comforted knowing that she has seen first the kingdom of God and you have added the rest to her. So bless us as we seek to worship you this morning, as we say thanks in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the blessed Holy Spirit. Amen and amen.
Continue in prayer. Let us share in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as
their labor and their works do follow them. With this service of thanksgiving, we are gathered with mixed feelings. For some of us, it's a time we are experiencing deep grief, and yet we are rejoicing, knowing and confident that our sister lived a full life, offering herself in service and submission to her Savior. And so we extend welcome on behalf of our pastor, Reverend David Thomas, officers and members of this church family. Truly, as we pause to celebrate the life, we offer our own thanksgiving to God for this life that God gave to us, this life that God loaned to us. I believe we are better for meeting her, and I also believe that all of us were touched by her life. And so on behalf of the church family, extend condolences on behalf of pastor and members, condolences to the family and all those who are mourning. The tributes are outlined for us. We will receive from the Burchell Memorial Baptist Church class 2 and 5, classes 2 and 5, certain deacons, Venturia, Porto, and the video team. We invite them to come in that order.
Members of the bereaved family, on behalf of Pastor Reverend David C. Thomas, deacons and other church council members, and the membership of the Burchell Circle of Baptist Churches, I'm extending to you our deepest sympathy on the passing of your relative and our sister and friend, Deacon Norma Graham. We share your grief because she was an integral part of the Burchell family, one who cared deeply for us and was well loved by all. We pray that the God of all comfort will grant you the fortitude and the courage to bear the loss. Thank you for the many years that you shared her with us. We recognize that there were times when we could have robbed you of her presence, but she was working for her Lord and enjoyed doing it. Thanks for your understanding. Take comfort in the knowledge that her life was lived for Christ, and if we do the same, we will meet her on that great resurrection day. Remember to cast your cares upon the Lord, and He will. Burchell Memorial Baptist Church, remembering the late Deacon Norma Elaine Brigham. Her journey. Don't think of her as gone away. Her journey's just begun. Life holds so many facets. This earth is only one. Just think of her as resting from the sorrows and the tears, in a place of warmth and comfort where there are no days or years. Just think how she must be wishing that we could know today how nothing but our sadness can really pass away. And think of her as living in the hearts of those she touched, for nothing loved is ever lost, and she has loved so much. Today, we honor the life and celebrate the work and memory of our sister, Deacon Norma Elaine Brigham. On the 1st of June 1958, a little girl, 12 years old, Norma Elaine Days, was baptized at the Salters Hill Baptist Church here in St. James. She grew in the fear and admonition of the Lord and increased in knowledge. 12 years later, on August 2, 1970, This same young lady, now Mrs. Norma Graham, was received on a transfer of membership into the family of the Burchell Memorial Baptist Church. She was a member of Class 5 and later became a member of Class 2. This membership lasted for over 49 years. Sister Graham immersed herself into the life of the church. Not even the physical maladies of life could dampen her zeal in doing God's work. Her enthusiasm, loyalty, and devotion to God's work did not go unnoticed. So in January of 1982, she was selected to serve as an officer and was later dedicated as a member of the church's officers' board, now renamed Church Council. Our sister was also chosen to be a leader for Class 5 and was later ordained a deacon of the church. Deacon Norma Graham was elected an assistant treasurer of the church, and on the resignation of the then treasurer due to ill health, she moved up to the position of treasurer. A few years ago, she was elected assistant treasurer for the circuit, a position she served in up to the time of. Our sister served on various committees, including finance, scholarships, and the ushers board, and was also a member of the Christian Endeavors Union and Adult Family Hour Class 4. Her family, our teacher and class president of the Christian Endeavor Union, remembers Deacon Graham as one who was an integral part of the CE, who contributed generously to all activities. As a member of the family of our class, she brought a wealth of biblical knowledge to the class and was able to give valid explanations when necessary. Deacon Graham was a consummate class leader. One member of the class stated that everyone who wanted to could go to her with their problems, and she would help them to find a solution through Christian love and prayer. Another member recalled that you could go to her with any matter that was confidential. She said that Deacon Graham's shoulder was always available for the whosoever to rest on. She had the mental, physical, and spiritual capacity to listen without being judgmental, to help without setting conditions, to understand with empathy, and to love no matter what. This class was always on top with harvest and fundraising. Deacon Graham was a sister, a mother, a friend, one who knew how to love and was able to love and care for everyone. If you were hurting, feeling down in spirits, if you were confused, or you simply just needed an extra hug, she was the one on whom you would call. Her caring extended beyond being physical. Many persons knew what it was like to be a beneficiary of her generous financial endorsement in very practical ways. She was patient in listening and prayerful in her responses. Our sister displayed a high level of enthusiasm for God's work and became a member of a group of 10 women in the church called Pioneers for Christ. This group was instrumental in effecting improvement in the physical appearance of the chapel. This included the retiling of the floor and the removal of the baptistry to its present location. As the team leader for fundraising functions then, Deacon Graham spearheaded the planning and execution of several such functions. She utilized the managerial experiences gained in her family business to monitor the finances of the church so that the bills would always be paid. Deacon Graham studied and understood God's word, thus was able to, on several occasions, to bring the message at worship services. Her work in church did not go unrewarded. Thus, some years ago, she was selected by Burchell to receive the St. James Baptist Association's Award for services rendered to the church and community. In August of 2014, along with other members of the church family, she was recognized for faithful and dedicated service at Virgin. Over the past few years, our sister experienced ill health at varying times and was not able to attend worship services regularly and to carry out her various responsibilities at church. During this time, she maintained her relationship with her church family. A few months ago, she was admitted to the hospital more than once. During these times spent there, she used the opportunity to witness to her fellow patients. She lived a life of selfless service as a dedicated child of God and led her children to accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and personal Savior. On the morning of October 3, 2019, while lying in bed at home and being quite conscious of what was happening to her, Deacon Graham told her family members who were with her that she was going home. Based on her life and works in Christ, on that morning, she would not have been deceptive if she had declared, "I have glorified thee on the earth, and I have finished the work which you gave me to do." Deacon Graham peacefully made her transition with members of her family by her side. We never lose the ones we love, for love itself lives on. And the joy we know together is never really gone. It lives in precious memories of those who were so dear, memories that bring comfort and keep our loved ones near. So when my last breath shall rend the veil in twain, by death I shall escape from death and life eternal gain. Sweet sea, Deacon Norman Delaney Graham.
Oh. We can fly higher than we could. Shall we bless the Lord? Shall we worship the Lord in the beauty of his holiness? Shall we just lift up the highest praise? Hallelujah! The Lord God Almighty reigns. He reigns today. He was yesterday, and he is to come. We come into this place today with a spirit of gratefulness, an attitude of thankfulness. We thank the Lord for his grace. We thank him for his mercy. We honor him, hallelujah, with our praise. And today in this place, we are going to praise the Lord because he is still worthy of all praise, of all glory, of all honor. Sister Norma loved praise and worship. Even as I stand here, I can see her face. Hallelujah. She always encouraged us, even when it doesn't sound so good. She always had a pleasant face. She encouraged each and every one of us here to stand in our truth. And today we just want to honor her and honor God for her contribution to our team. So please stand up with me. We're going to praise the Lord. We're going to sing, "I've Got My Mind Made Up." Because I want to see my Jesus someday. I've got my mind made up, and I won't turn back, because I want to see my Jesus.
I'm on the road.
comes as majesty. We worship His majesty. And if I'm honest, that's also my favorite song because of just how we worship His holy name. With this song, I feel like it's the utmost praise that I can give unto the Lord. When I sing majesty, unto Jesus be all glory, be all honor, be all praise. And when the words can't come, I sing the same majesty. Worship His majesty. Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings.
Hallelujah.
We sing majesty.
Let you know that, or to inform you
that not so long ago, or perhaps I should say one of the last discussions I had with Sister Graham, just about the end of July, she said to us as we stood around her bedside, "Brother Duke, when I die, ensure that there's more singing than talking." And so I am here at this point to announce for the tributes that are coming, ensure that if you didn't plan to sing, you sing a tribute. Kumi is here, and the others are as follows: Miss Angela Henry, musical selection by the Bell's family, Sister Marion Bowen, Mark Richards, Mrs. Cynthia Dove, Elva Clark, Apostle Keisha Campbell, Expressions Children, Mrs. Dietrich French, and the Providence Church. We invite you to come in that form.
Good morning, everyone. As you said, we represent Kumi. And some over 16 years ago, I had the pleasure of Mr. Roy Bryan introducing me. And Norma became a very good friend of mine, one of my best friends. And she also got interested in what we were doing at Kumi, which stands for the Committee for the Upliftment of the Mentally Ill. Later on, her interest grew, and she then decided to join our board of directors, and she has been a great supporter. She has been an inspiration to us many a times when we've had meetings and how we're going to manage Kumi. And the clients that you see on here today are the end product of Norma's input. So we want to just remember Norma and make a special tribute to her, because this is the first time our clients are ever doing anything like this. So please be with us. So I'll hand over. So on the behalf of the board of directors, the staff team members of Kumi, we wish to make this final tribute to Norma, because we loved her so much and we will continue to love her. And so we want to make sure that we pay her tribute on her final row. And we'll hand over to Nurse Jennings, who's going to organize our clients.
Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon. You know the Bible speaks about the least you do to one of these, you do it unto me. Yes. Indeed, Mrs. Bryan was one of them who been doing for the least of these. As Mrs. Cook say, we are from Kumi, and Kumi is a day center for mentally challenged people. So for her to be contributing, to be thinking about the least of these, indeed she must have been a great woman, which we can attest to today. Your presence here today and our presence that this lady had the time to think about the least of these. And the Bible says when you think about the least of these, you will be great in God's kingdom. We are going to be singing a song. We know it's not easy, because for us at Kumi, our family, the community that you support, it's not an easy task to lose a gem like her. But we are asking you to just ride out the storm, because God is there with you.
Being in the storm.
Oh. extend my condolences to the bereaved family. I just want to let you know that I grieve with you and I also mourn with you. But God Almighty, your Heavenly Father, will heal your hearts in due season. Bless the Lord.
Life has been so good, I can't complain. When I hurt, Lord, give me strength to rise again. But when I look on the struggle,
stop! Thank you. God was on the streets. The gates swing open wide, and oh, my
after that stellar performance. I am here to represent the Bells family. My name is Vinetil, and the Bells family is a relative of Mrs. Graham. They grew up together in this ongoing exercise for Mrs. Graham, who has contributed most, if it's not all, of her life to public servant. And we just celebrate with the family today, and the Lord will take care. Praise God. Praise God. I'm going to try to see if I can be in the number in the top five. I went to the house where she used to live. The grass has grown tall and covered the door. Someone across the street said, I know who you see, but she don't live there.
trees where she spent most of her life. The storm, it was still there, and pictures were taken as usual.
Norma Graham at Dr. Morris's nursing home many years ago. No wonder she became a nurse, as she portrayed all the qualities a nurse and Christian should have. She has finished her course. She has kept the faith. So, beloved sister, sleep on and take your rest. May God perpetuate your life, shine upon you, and keep you. Amen.
The sky shone on a foam, preparing his entrance. The stars will to praise.
The
that great triumph upon you. May we all shall rise, and there will be weeping on that happy old nation. Sweet one.
Good afternoon, church. Yes, no, I'm not Elbo. This is Elbo. She's not so well today, and I'm Leslie. We stand here representing the Clark family and to pay homage to an exceptional woman of God who shared over 50 years of friendship with our mother, Faye Clark. There's no time in our lives that we did not know Auntie Norma. In all those years, we can use one word to describe how we felt when we were around her, loved. Whenever you were around Auntie Norma, you felt loved. Truly, she had availed herself as God's vessel, and his love flowed in and through her. Her warm and radiant smile, even when she was in pain and discomfort, somehow managed to put us at peace. Over the years, Auntie Norma was more than a good and genuine friend to our mother. She was a true sister, a sister in Christ. They kept in touch constantly, speaking often, encouraging each other, praying together, and sharing about the lives of their children and grandchildren. Often they reminisced about their time being part of the virtual church service room back in the day called the Pioneers. We thank God for placing her in our lives, for giving us the opportunity to fellowship with her. Even though the time feels so short, we are grateful. As a family, we will miss her thoughtfulness and caring ways, particularly through our difficult and most trying times, when our father died and our mother lost her sight. May we aspire to live as she did, according to the instructions given in Micah 6, verse 8. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly and to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. We express our condolences to her family, church family, employees, and anyone who had the privilege of knowing her. May she rest in sweet heavenly peace, and may light shine perpetually on her. We cannot, Lord, thy purpose to you, but all is well that's done right. Thank you.
We're going to try to honor Auntie Norma's wishes for her singing. Not very well, but I will go back to the classes.
Oh, my heart to him I give, ever to him I cling. In his blessed presence live, ever his praises sing. Love so mighty and so
God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
For everything there is a season.
Yes.
A time to be born and a time to die.
Amen.
And we give God the glory that this lady has lived a life that is pleasing to God. And we don't weep like one that doesn't have any hope, because we have a hope to see her one day. In the dark of the midnight, as I often hid my fear, as the storms howls above me, and there's no hiding place, and the crash of the thunder crashes, Lord, hear my cry, keep them safe till the storm passes by. Till the storm passes over and the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds fall forever from the sky.
Oh, afternoon. My name is Deetra, and Norma was my aunt by marriage. If you can't tell, I'm not Jamaican. So what I have been asked to read to you today is from her children. It's their expression today. There is patois in it, and I am not Jamaican. Feel free to laugh with me, not at me, as I attempt to be sure that what they want to convey to you is left with you today. Rays from the sunshine of Norma Elaine Graham, shining through Garth, Gail, Geisha, and Gavin. Garth has his mother's gift for quiet resolution. You can listen to his momentary silence, watch the shaking of his head, and hear in his sigh these unspoken words, "My mother, a woman of silent strength." You get the sense of, "Ah, tell you why, can't believe this is happening, but we walking through it, we will get it done, resolute." Gail, her quick actions to get the bills paid, to get the shirts for the staff ready, to meet with new clients, to get the yard cut, and on, speaks of her mother too. In what these words now say, "My mother, virtuous to the business of life, no matter what." Geisha, for a moment of overcome with physical discomfort, decided that this would not limit her from doing what must. She picks up her phone and sends a message. It simply reads this: "The one who now watches over us was a stalwart of God, a caring mother, a prayer warrior. The word angel could describe her, a hard worker, a loving wife, a fabulous grandmother, a giver, encourager, and a friend. Indeed, Mummy was not just our mother, but one to countless others also. A phenomenal woman, boasting the best integrity." In this action, Geisha's words come to life. "My mother, limitless, striving at all times to do her best." Gavin, here it goes. "What una wami fa say now? All right, come listen, make me tell you." The moment Gavin begins to speak, a humor buzzes the phone line and springs to life the ears listening. He shows his mother's uncanny, timeless sense of humor, her way of taking the weight from a heavy situation. Gavin speaks of his mother as one whose life's work gave him his purpose. In his words, we hear my mother, my confidant. My mother was a very giving person. She was always giving, not just to us, but to so many others. She was my best friend. She was always there for people, and now I do community outreach myself. Gavin does not have to say it was because of Mommy. Geisha does not have to say, "I am getting off my sick bed to do work because Mommy would have done the same." Gail does not have to shout to the world that why the business of work must continue because Mommy would have come to work. Garth does not have to tell everyone that, "You know, I am quietly strong because my mother was strong in silence." Her reflections often spoke more than her words. Why not? They do not have to tell because their actions are already speaking louder than words. These four speak now for their mother in ways seen easily and ways that move quietly, effectively. It is true that if we catch them in conversation, you will hear such words uttered as, "Mummy is my motivation, my ambassador, my confidant, my advisor, my anchor, my superhero." You will also hear memorable morsels like this one: "Mummy was protective, and yes, she was serious. If you sat at church and talked, you would catch her eye from the platform. We did not understand it back then, but why she grew us humble. Humble and respectful for adults, She taught us to be helpful to the needy, to set our goals. She used to say, pace yourself, do not be envious, and know that no matter how you think you are powerful, at the end of it all, God has the last say. Or tidbits like this one. Boy, mommy was an all-rounder, master juice blender. Mommy made cake, juice, full meal. Boy, I don't know how she do it, but when her foot a painter, I told you, she sit down at the counter and blend. But now the blender is silent. She was an excellent swimmer. Despite her walking with a cane, we would get her to the beach, help her into the water, and she would take off, swimming out to greens or doing several laps. She loved the water. You can even hear this ultimate truth. Mommy was in love with Jesus, I tell you. Jesus was the love of her life and her best friend. You could even come into the office and not see her right away. And she was in that little spot. I don't know how she gets into it, kneeling down and praying. Sometimes she would be flat on her face at home, or you wake up at night and there she was, praying. She knew things in our lives before we did. We would call her to tell her stuff, and she would begin telling me. I don't think Mommy was human. I asked Daddy how he handled being the second love of her life. I had to ask him, because as I tell you, Jesus was her first love. She is with her first love now, so we cannot complain. Yes, if you catch them in conversation, you will hear them speak of her in those accurate ways. But better than that, watch them, and you will see them shine her beauty. G for Garth, G for Gail, G for Geisha, G for Gavin, G for Norma Graham's S-U-N-S, sons. Believe it or not, G is not only the seventh letter of the alphabet, sitting in a place of completion. It is a letter which in Greek is called sun, meaning S-U-N, sun. You see, she set them up for the last laugh. She knew that mere words could not speak their heart at this time. Words cannot always express the depth of warmth, hope, adoration, and strength that a life like hers gave to so many. She knew more than words that their lives would. So today and onward, when you listen to Garth, Gail, Geisha, and Gavin speak of Mommy, listen to their lives and watch them shine.
Good afternoon, everyone. For me, she was Miss G. I came to know her a great while back. There are a few things that I know that for those of us who would have known her, we'll take from here. And that's the smile that she always carries, and the fact that she always had an encouraging word. She started a part of her early years at the Salters Hill Baptist Church, and she was a family member of Monica, who is standing close beside me, who is a member of the Providence Baptist Church. And she was very, very close to Dr. Myra Powell Pusey, now deceased. She was very close in relationship with her. As we minister, we want to encourage the family that the eternal God is your refuge, and underneath are his everlasting arms.
I long to gain my treasures waiting upon the other side beyond tomorrow.
believe that Sister Graham would be proud and she would feel good. Not true? Except for the children and Mrs. French. They didn't sing. Great indulgence as we take one more from Reverend Glendon Powell, after which we invite Reverend Conrad Thomas to offer prayer for the family.
Good afternoon again. The Unity Hall opened by the church and the Powell's family pays tribute to a distinguished woman of God, Mrs. Norma Graham. We want to first use the medium to express our deepest sympathy and condolences to the family and friends, and to ask that you rest assured that God will link the broken chains as by one we will meet again. Mrs. Grant has been specially known to my family for over 30 years. Over these years, I have known her to be a very serious, committed Christian, one who was very courageous, and one who shows unwavering faith in her God. No wonder she was made a deacon in this noble institution, the Jamaica Baptist Union, and by extension, the Birchill Baptist Church. I came closer to her when my wife joined the staff at Ventura Photo Studio. My wife says she was an extraordinary manager, a mother, a mentor, a model. Mrs. Graham was genuine. She was caring. She did not leave off her nurse calling. She was kind. She exudes countless Christ-like principles or qualities. One can never come in contact with her and not loving her. Mrs. Graham sojourned in this life was a very productive, very profitable, very powerful, and a very rewarding one. She brought charisma, integrity, love, grace, and respect to the world when she was alive. Indeed, she can be described as an entire package, a lady of class, a gem. Today, in paying tribute to her, let us reflect on our own lives. Examine our contribution to our country and to our people. Let Mrs. Graham's life act as a benchmark to gauge our own life as we ask ourselves, are we doing enough to touch the lives and to affect eternity? I thank the Almighty and her family for sharing her with us. Family members and friends, let's be reminded, like the Apostle Paul, Mrs. Graham has fought a good fight. She has finished her race, and most importantly, she has remained faithful to her people and her God. Family, hang on to the good times. Trust in God. Rely on Him, for He will provide you with strength to hurdle each trying moment as you mourn. She has done her duty excellently, leaving a legacy that will outlive all of us. Let's hold on to the words of Watford, who said, "The heart has its own memory, like the mind, and it is enshrined by the precious memories we keep, in which is wrought in the giver." Loving thoughts. Today, we want more as though we do not have any hope. For death is not the extinguishing of the light, but only the putting out of the lamp, because the day, the dawn, has come. I know that her soul is resting in peace, and light perpetual is shining upon her. God bless you.
This is indeed a good time to worship God. This is a good place to worship God. Sister Norma has settled the account, and precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. I invite the congregation to stand, and then ask the family members to remain seated as we lift the bereaved to God in prayer. Let us bow. Father God of all consolation, you have sent light into darkness, the presence and power of your Son, Jesus the Christ. His death and resurrection have given us the victory over death itself. We are surrounded with Paul's confidence to pose the question, O death, where is your sting? In the shadow of this death which now clouds the joy of your people, we now call upon you, O God, that you may lift us up to new life, we might find the gift of tears, a tribute to the love the Father has shown us in the life of Norma. God of our fathers, we never cease to thank you for the new life which comes from your creative hands. In our tears we beg you to fill the emptiness which attacks us in the face of death. Speak to us all, O God of comfort. In this day when death is near us, that we may set our hope and trust on you. That though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we will fear no evil, for you are with us. We intercede with deliberate energy for those who are left to mourn this death. A husband, Roy. Daughters, Gail and Geisha. Sons, Garth and Gavin, a church family, and a host of others who are now grieving and mourning. At this moment, we know that nothing seems to be able to help the feeling of loss. With a broken heart and a mourning spirit, we stand bare before you, conscious that your grace is sufficient. This day, this hour, moment by moment, grant to all who are deeply distressed the urgency to lean upon you. Cause us to remember that at our weakest, your strength is strongest. Grant that all who mourn this hour may pour out their grief to you, the rock of all ages. May we praise you that on one glorious day, when all all suffering is extinguished and love has conquered, we shall walk together with Norma yet again. Forgive us in your mercy and strengthen us by your Spirit, that we, living in faith and righteousness, may be found ready when you shall have called us to our everlasting home in you. Fill us again with your life-giving Spirit, that with one voice we might profess our belief that the life that comes to an end here is but the beginning of life with you forever. Hear the spur in the name of our death-conquering Lord, Jesus Christ, your Son. Amen.
Graham very well, you would know that she was a generous person. If you knew her very well, you would agree with me that she was a giving individual. But I remember on one occasion when I visited these parts, I went and to visit, sat in her office. That was her custom. She would say, "Brother, do things rough." But she dipped in her bag and she searched around and she found some cash. She said, "Brother, do hold on to this." Was a bit hesitant because each time I come, she would give me something. Started feeling guilty as if, why, wonder if I should visit Sister Graham. But if she heard that I came and I didn't visit, I would be in trouble. So I reluctantly took the money she was giving to me. Not long after, somebody buzzed her door and she let in the person, and it was somebody from the courier. She signed for the envelope. She opened it in front of me. And there in it was a check for some money. Sister Graham, in her own straightforward self, for lack of a better word, threw the check in front of me and said, "Brother, do a better one show off for me too. You can't stop feeling blessed." You understand? "Brother, you can't stop the blessing." She was a giving individual. We are, on this occasion, going to follow her example to be giving individuals as we give this offering to the Leo Robbins Scholarship Fund, a fund which assists students going to tertiary institutions. We wait on the ushers as they come, and I ask that you remain seated so that you will have easy access to the bottom of the box. We invite, as the ushers have come, Reverend Joseph Anderson will offer prayer.
We give you thanks, Eternal God, that you are a giver, very generous. Your hand is always open, extended to all of us. We know your generosity. We praise you for the gift you have given to us, Sister Norma, a gift to her husband, to her children, her family, her friends, her church. Thank you that she was a giver. She was generous. Instilling us this spirit of generosity even now, as we are given an opportunity to contribute to this scholarship fund. We know you'll accept it, and you'll bless it, and you'll use it as intended for the benefit of those who receive from it. We pray you'll have your way, Lord, and to bless and strengthen us, for Christ's sake.
Amen. Lord, be
from the Old Testament, Psalm 90, verses 1 through 12, to be read by Justin Graham, grandson. The New Testament reading, Romans 8, verses 28 through 39, to be read by Prophet Ron Barnett and the family. We invite you to come.
So, hello, good evening, or good afternoon. My cousin Justin over there is not feeling so well, so I'm going to be stepping into his place. I'll be reading Psalms 90, verse 1 through 12. Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations, before the mountains were brought forth, or even though hast formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. Thou turnest man to destruction, and saith, return the child of men. For 1,000 years in thy sight, and are but as yesterday when it is past, and as a watch in the night. Thou carrieth them away as a flood. They are as asleep in the morning, they are like grass which groweth up. In the morning it flourishes and groweth up. In the evening it is cut down and withered. For we are consumed by thin anger, and by thy wrath are troubled. Thou hast set our iniquities before thee, our secret sins in the light of thy countenance. For all our days are passed away in thy wrath. We spend our years as tales that is told. The days of our years are 70 years and 10. And if by reason of strength they be 80 years, yet is the strength labor and sorrow, for it is soon cut off, and we fly away. We know of the power of thine anger, even according to thy fear, so thy wrath. So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts upon wisdom.
Good afternoon, everyone. I greet you in the mighty name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Can I just ask the church a simple question? Do you know that God speaks? I'm not talking about a mind reading God. I'm talking about a God that speaks tangibly. While I was sitting there, the Lord said I should challenge this church. And I took my rag out and he said to me, tell the people prophetically, wipe away their tears. The Lord spoke to me and he said to me, the day Miss Graham came into the earth, there was a gathering of angelic beings. And the day she departed, there was a gathering of angelic beings. If you ask me, how do I know that? I'm a prophet. I don't need to ask anybody. Miss Graham is present with the Lord. I'm not guessing to tell you. I know. Can you just turn your Bibles with me to the book of Romans chapter 8, reading from verses 28. To 39, sorry.
And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the likeness of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those he predestined, he also called. Those he called, he also justified. Those he justified, he also glorified. What then shall we say in response to this? If God is for us, who can be against us?
He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who is he that condemns? Christ Jesus, who died more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God, and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword.
As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, nor present nor future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus, O Lord. Here ends a portion of God's holy word. We say thanks to God.
Reverend David C. Thomas has been tasked with the responsibility to interpret the mind of God and to declare his counsel in our midst. Before he comes, we will have a musical selection from the scene of one.
Oh, take our hands and to lead us in green pastures and to lead us through treacherous and precipitous moments of life. We want to thank the Lord for that rendition. Want to bring my colleagues who are here with us to celebrate and to help us carry the burden. And then next to say to my friends and members of this church, those who are members and those who are friends, those who I know so very well, Garth, Gail, and Geisha, and Gavin, and I always say Brother Chi, always say Brother Chi, God bless you, sir, and to your spouses and your children and other close relatives. I've already been said, but just reiterating, on behalf of all of us here at Birches and the entire circuit, and also to add Marcia, Andrea, and Andrew, please accept our sincerest and deepest condolences. We trust that the good Lord will grant you the strength that you need in this hour to navigate this very difficult time. May God continue to bless you. Those who are going to help me to sing, you can come, please. You have promised. I'm not seeing you. I don't want to have an overkill in singing, but there is this song I was singing in church one Sunday, and I really observed Deacon Graham's expression. Was deeply moved. And while I get ready to sing, to say that the Grams family is close to my family, and well, especially Miss G, as we call her, Sister Graham. So when my daughter was migrating, we thought she could never do so without personally going to the house and letting her know that Angela was migrating. So we all checked up to the house. She was ill. And it was almost like a reprimand. Pastor, you mean Andrea leaving today? Are you not telling me something? Can't give her something? I felt frightened. And then she shuffled across the bed and went to the dresser to find her purse, and was almost angry with herself when she did not see the amount in her purse that she would have given to her. But we spoke about her generosity, and that is just one little part of it. But she had other qualities too, right? I'm looking for my brother Sue. Brother Blair, he just went outside. Because when I tried to exercise, can't buy the fancy exercise machine. So I would go to the beach periodically. I could not keep up with Sister Norma at the beach when she went to me. But God is a wonderful, merciful friend. I would just want to share this with you before I say something in a short while, and then let us go.
Always hunger for, oh, our hearts always hunger. How when your whole heart was searching for a place
place of comfort. I don't know if you found her or she found you, but some kind of finding took place. You introduced me to her then. A caring, kind, sympathetic, compassionate person. I struggled for a sermon topic, but just want to use some moments from the life of Elijah to communicate some thoughts that were on my mind. And I just want to read something from 2 Kings chapter 13, from verse 14 to 25. And then I will say some things and close. Now Elijah had been suffering from the illness from which he died. Jehoash, king of Israel, went down to see him and wept over him. My father, he cried, the chariots and horsemen of Israel. Elijah said, get a bow and some arrows. And he did so. Take the bow in your hand, he said to the king of Israel. When he had taken it, Elijah put his hands on the king's hand. Open the east window, he said, and he opened it. Shout, Elijah said, and he shot rather, shoot, and he shot. The Lord's arrow of victory, the arrow of victory over Aram, Elijah declared, you will speak, you will completely destroy the Arameans at Aphek. Then he said, take the arrows, and the king took them. Elijah told him, strike the ground. He struck it 3 times and stopped. The man of God was angry with him and said, you should have struck the ground 5 or 6 times. Then you would have defeated Aram and completely destroyed it. But now you will defeat it only 3 times. Elijah died and was buried. And one verse, while they were doing some things, I just paraphrase, Elijah was being buried, or had been buried, and some people were passing, burying a man, and the man dropped in Elijah's grave, and touched his bones, and the dead man came back to life, the word of God. A believer's journey in life. You know, the first time I read this passage, it had an unusual effect upon me. And we looked at Elisha. I was like, chat a lot. The miracles that this man did. At his instruction, the Jordan River was divided. The waters at the spring of Jericho were healed. Bears from wood destroyed some children. The water for kids. Oil for a widow. You know, prayed for this barren woman and she had children. Son died, prayed over him, the boy come back. And I could go on and on. You can read. But then it said in verse 14 that Elijah, the prophet, was suffering from an illness from which he did not recover. The same man who could multiply miracles at random, as it were, the man was on his deathbed and he did not recover. See, that's if he had a terminal illness. If I read first again, now Elijah had been suffering from the illness from which he died. Now, this journey of Elijah showed him up, one, as vulnerable. Vulnerable. Powerful man of God. But you know, this powerful man of God, but son of human being. Vulnerable. And just, you know, Sister Norma reminded someone. She did surgeries.
not surgery. Surgery is ruining her life, Dad. And you know, we have spoken so graciously about her. She too was vulnerable. High risk. Risk. As human beings, no matter how close we are to God, we remain human beings. And Elisha, powerful. You know, this man got a double portion of Elijah's blessing. Wish we didn't get even a quarter portion. And even though that anointing, that unction, that empowering was so rich upon Elijah, the man dead, terminal illness. Man of God, son of human being. And we are vulnerable. All of us are vulnerable to sickness, to disease, to poverty. And I read somewhere else where one prophet died. And he was so broke. The prophet was so broke that people, the creditors come to enslave his son. As children of God, we are not immune from the idiosyncrasies and vicissitudes of this life. When we are part and parcel of it. And when we find ourselves healthy, we lift our hand and say, thank you, Jesus. It's not nothing good that we do. It's not because of our grace. It's not because of our preaching and some super endowment of something upon us. It's because of God's grace and God's mercy while we are. Vulnerable, at risk. At risk for anything. It's like all our lives today. We shall say, God, thank you for the opportunity to see. Thank you for the opportunity to hear. Thank you for the opportunity to see my family and my loved ones. God, we know stop quarreling and complaining. This is life that I have because I'm vulnerable. Today we are here and tomorrow we're gone. Risk, vulnerability, set in power. But when I look at Deacon Graham's vulnerability to illness, some people will say, I'm reading Job, you know. You know, they try to tell Job, say, no, that good man, that's why he's sick. Elisha. But by the way, I wanted to move on to the second thing. But you know that Stephen,
yes.
Why you call him ultra righteous? Yes. A devout man of God.
Yes.
What they do to Stephen?
Yes.
Oh, and sometimes I feel it when the rock hits Stephen.
Yes.
Vulnerable. Risk to the evils of this world sometimes. Vulnerable to the thoughts. Vulnerable to the bad folk. Vulnerable to everything. Because we remain children of God. But I say to you, if your vulnerability is being exposed by some cruel and some senseless people today, press along, saints. Press along in God's own time. Persecution you must bear, you will bear. Trials and troubles come your way, but I have to the victory. God is and God will be.
Yes.
You know, when I went to visit, you know, sometimes I went to visit Sister Norman up at Norman and Richard said, Pastor, you come. Pastor, you never have to come in, we'll say you're busy.
Yes.
And she giving instruction. Loving God. But when I see the prophet, as not only vulnerable, but I also see him as venerable. High respect. Risk and respect. Any Anglican can replicate the most venerable bishop. The most respected one, archdeacon, venerable. That which is worthy of high respect. But you know, when Elijah died, you know, who came? When he was sick on his deathbed, you know who came to visit him? The king. The king respected him. Even though he said some harsh things about the king sometimes. Because prophets, you know what prophets do? that speak truth to power. Prophets speak truth to power. And sometimes the power and the hierarchies of life are more strong, but somebody has to speak truth to power. And that's what the prophets do. And even though Elijah spoke truth to power, the king was there because he respected the man. You know, sometimes in our country, the power brokers, sometimes the power brokers go on like them own way. And if they say jump, we have to jump. But I wonder who is speaking truth to power these days. Because some of us love the things that the powerful people give away. Some of us love to be by their side, to get right in them plane and in them big car. And so we're not challenging them. But Elijah spoke truth to power and to the powerful. We need to, a lot of things in Jamaica that powerful people need to hear. You have a picture on the order of service with Sister Norma in the pulpit. And what do you see?
Yes.
A prophet that speaking truth to power. Yes, venerable, respected. But you are here because you respect God too. We respect the grace. Respect the inside. And today I heard something new, that she was that kind of prophet that said you were going to be pastor. And they love her. And love her. Love her was going to be pastor. Why? And Rochelle is here. And she prophesied that you're going to be pastor. Why? That one of my father's prophecy to me. Venerable, respected. And so because of respect, you see the man service here Thursday night. Holy, another faith. Respect. When Sister Norma died, give my sermon this kind of a eulogy to be rescued in some way. I went by Ventura Market Street. Did I see veneration there? Yes. I saw big men and little men and big woman and little woman above. Down by Market Street, Ventura. Because of the deep respect. So maybe if she were on the country, you'd have heard the most venerable Norma Elaine Graham. Vulnerable illnesses, surgeries, human, but respected. But the other thing I saw about Elijah, that I also want to communicate, the man did not only show his vulnerability, human. But I'm only venerable. The king himself, the one who fits. But I saw Elijah as valuable. Those who lived when he lived saw his value. Can you imagine? This woman credited coming to take her two sons. And Elijah said, gather up the containers that you can find and buy them off road. My lord, she felt to have her two sons not being carted away in slavery. The man was valuable. I hear you speaking today about a valuable person in community. And not just value simply because of what she could give. Because you have to be careful who value you. always say, when a kindergarten child starts to mark your PhD thesis, you have to be careful. I'm not sure if they can understand the language or anything. What about grade you? And some people will, they say, Elijah was valued and so was Sister Norma. That's why I'm not crying. And sorry, I came over here today, but I didn't want to get too turbulent. Valuable. Some people devalue us. Take away from who we are. It's not easy living with somebody where we think we're going to put it on. I'm trying to make you seem like something else that you are not. A prophecy to uplift. A prophecy that engenders hope in one's life. Seeing our value and allowing us to be taken to another step. That's powerful. Oh, how we need to hear good words. You need truth to power, but you need something that can build you also. Not something to devalue you. But no true prophet ever devalue anybody. They speak so that people can be better. Speak that people can be better. And we see value. But with value, sometimes there's assessment. After assessment, when you try to look at value, then you might have appreciation or degree. Let the dollar, appreciate or devalue. You know when the dollar devalue a serious something for your pocketbook. When people devalue seriously. I hope nobody here not devaluing anybody. But we're not putting down anybody to make you look big. And some people can put a value on you that is not true value because they have bad intention in mind. Some people can beat you up, but it's flattery. You have to be careful of how people value you to get something from you. You have to know yourself, and God wants us to know yourself. That we say be strong in the Lord and the power of His might so that we will not be deceived.
Gonna date, when the person looks like somebody come out and know about and know you put in a dinosaur here, they won't tell them how pretty they are. Yes. No. And never mind. But we'll share a little thing. I'm good. We're saying that as I look at Elijah, look at his vulnerabilities. Powerful prophet, but yet a terminal illness. Sickness from which he did not recover. I have a friend of mine, he's a prominent pastor. I'm not saying he must be like him, he believed in God, but he said anytime he go anywhere and the doctor tell him that C word, he says that to pop up in jewels. I'm not saying he must do that because we believe in power. I pray. And God can do a lot of things. Just like he did it for the Shunammite the other year, he can do it again. Because God, what God did then, God can do it again because He's not a God that sleeps. He's not a God that slumbers. And I tell you some church, and you know it too. Our God don't go on vacation. Our God don't take sick leave. Our God don't take departmental leave. He's always there. You can call on Him any time of day and night. We have in Jesus all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege! When we are at our wit's end, we can call on Him. When we are at risk, so He knows us in our vulnerabilities. He makes us vulnerable. Some of us were nowhere. We were like this scum of society. People never even look at us. We didn't have pedigree nor nothing, pedigree nor degree. People see us on the road and pass us.
But some sweet day Jesus came into our heart and a new song is being sung. Look at me now, since Jesus came into my heart, I'm a rebel, respected because of Christ Jesus. Even King of come away, even big people that come from Broadway, because God has moved us from sinking sand. He has taken us from miry clay, and he has planted our feet on the rock to stay. I hear somebody say, and that is the reason I sing and I shout, my Jesus came down and he lifted me up. And I rebel and respect him. Did I hear somebody say, my venerable church sister? Did I hear somebody say, my most venerable church brother? Are you that? You have become part of a royal good family. And then we say, well, valuable. Yes. Some of you people make you feel like you are worth anything. But God. But God. Allow me. You anybody feel what it means to be rejected deliberately? Push up. Because I never see any value in you.
Yes, sir.
You are a scum of society. You don't have any big this and any big that. But you are created in the image of God. Valuable. No, can anybody take that from you? After Elijah died and was buried, we see something, you know. By the way, please do not let the tears confuse your ears. Because the king started to cry. The sentiment. The king started to cry. My father, my father. But the man of God held his composure and said, even the book of my deathbed, I still prophet.
That's right.
Even though I'm on my deathbed, I'm still prophet. So the tears can confuse what drops upon your ears. And it becomes sentimental and stir up your heart. But he said, get the arrow and shoot. You got God, people of God, people on their deathbed. God, people are God, people and can still sing and testify. When some people are in trouble, they talk about them, go look. I will make you.
Right.
Go look about. Go look about. I've got a God. I've got a moment and God makes you. And God knows when to take you. He knows how to maintain you. He knows how to preserve you. The prophet did not even call the other school, the prophet, to pray. He must start to prophesy upon him. And shoot. And he still had a rich discerning spirit. While he had this terminal illness, he had this rich discerning spirit. Man, why you never shoot the arrow 6 and 5 times? Come on now, get some protein out of your mouth. When God has talked to you, now take it halfway. Now take it quarter way. Go all the way. Shoot your arrow 6 times. Why stop? So when you're feeling down, no time to stop. Be encouraged. Somebody said, speak over yourself. So when somebody not talk over you, draw in the inner recesses that God has given to you, because greater is he that is in you than he. Somebody needs to praise God here today. Greater. What will we leave behind? You get that?
Yes.
When you're dead gone,
you will have gone dangerous, confusing, all consuming, crazy,
citadel of confusion and chaos, the cacophony of confusion. And she, some people said, oh, somebody. That person was that terror, a mix of a bad mind, can't appreciate her. God was still speak. When Elisha gave time, God was still speak. When the dead man body touched Elijah's bone, oh, something start to happen. Oh, when we are gone from Virgil, when we are gone from our different churches, will we give life to somebody? Will our life inspire truth and righteousness? Is that we learn from it? Because for us in the Bible, everybody will come back. Everybody worries from the dead. As a matter of fact, when the dead will not, nobody pray that they rise up again. Because you understand? But I do mean that. And maybe the world will be in that place, get another prophet. But when we do what God asks us to do, because He's God, He can stir them. But we close by saying the life brings to mind the resurrection. That dead man was not really resurrected because he was dead again. But he was resuscitated, revived, come back to life. But does that give us a hint of the resurrection through our Lord Jesus Christ? That when we live for Him, when we believe in Him, when we accept Him and don't refuse Him, all those of us who are God's children shall also reign with Him. We shall reign with Him. We shall all rise to meet Him. We will be there. Because when the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, the dead in Christ shall rise to be with our Lord forever. Some sweet day, when life is over, we will meet our loved ones in the new Jerusalem. Oh, Jerusalem, that new place that God has gone to prepare. And so we do not mourn as people without hope, because our sister lives again in Jesus. New life springs eternal, as it were. God bless you. We thank God that in her vulnerability she did not reject God. We thank God that she maintained that kind of honorable respect. Venerable. We thank God that her value was displayed for all to see, and we will meet in the sweet by and by. Take care. God bless you. Walk good and live good in Jesus' name.
Invite you to stand as if you are able to. Let us join in singing the hymn, Jesus is all the world to me.
My joy, my joy. Great God Almighty, shelter in our times of storms, rock in our weary land, comfort in our moments of despair. We acknowledge you in all our ways, and even in the events that befall us, in sorrow of heart, and yet in quietness and confidence, we approach you as frail and flawed humanity, requesting your enabling grace. Our hearts have been made heavy by the transition of your servant, Norma, beloved wife, mother, grandmother, sister, and friend. Our hearts have been broken with grief. Our voices are crying out with words of lament. Our souls are conflicted, and yet we rejoice confident that she has found perfect peace with you. To many, she was. To many, she extended care and compassion. To many, she offered the listening ear of a confidant. To many, she was a strong tower, offering wealth of wisdom, years of experiences, soft shoulders to lean on. Help us, O thou, help us, O thou, great God, that through her death, grasp more firmly the hope that life is longer than our years, and your love shown to us is stronger than death in Jesus Christ. Oh, great God, we are grateful like your servant Elijah. We remember Sister Norma as someone who was vulnerable to sorrow, to sadness, to sickness, vulnerable to despair, to destruction, to death. Oh God, we thank you. Even though she was vulnerable, yet we remember that she too was venerable. Oh God, we remember your servant or mother or sister, someone who was worthy of higher respect. Respect from my family, respect from friends, respect even from foes. Oh God, we thank you that she was valuable. Valuable to you, her Christ, her commander, her comforter. Valuable to her community. Valuable to her church. Gracious God, we thank you that not only was your servant venerable, and valuable, but God, we declare today that your servant was indeed victorious. Indeed, victorious over sickness, victorious over sadness, victorious even over death. For death shall have no command. Death, oh death, where is thy sting? Oh grave, where is thy victory? God, gracious God, we bow before you, thanking you. God of life and death, life beyond death, we gather today remembering and to aware of the fragility of life, all to aware of the pain in this world, to aware of the brokenness that even death has thrust upon your people. Move in our hearts, Lord, and remind us through the veil of tears there is still hope. Remind us that though we live, and by the grace that we live, remind us that we are loved in life and we are loved in
in death. Remind us, oh God, remind Brother G, remind the children, the grandchildren, that God, we are never alone. Draw near now to us, all thou invisible comforter, and help us as we hear the promise of your word to believe them and to receive the comfort they offer, that indeed you are the giver of hope. Fill us today, Lord, with joy and peace in believing that our fears may be dispelled, our loneliness eased, and our hope reawakened through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We will sing our recessional hymn, "When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whate'er my lot thou hast sought me to say, it is well with my soul."
Thank you. feeling small when tears are
Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you for the life of your servant, Norma Elaine Graham. We thank you for the friendship she gave and for the strength and peace she brought, for the love she offered and received while she was on earth. We pray that nothing good in this woman's life would be lost, but will be of benefit to the world, and that all that was important to her will be respected by those who follow. We ask that those of us who were close to her may now, because of her death, be close to one another and be aware of your love present through all things. Almighty God, Father of all mercies and giver of all comfort, deal graciously, we pray, with those who mourn, that casting all their care on you, they may know the consolation of your love. And O God of infinite compassion, look in love and pity on your sorrowing servants. Be thou their support, be their strength, be their shield, that they may trust in you and be delivered out of any distress and darkness that they might be experiencing at this time, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We invite you to take the cup and down, please. We remind ourselves, as is written in the word, Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. From henceforth, that they may rest from their labors, and their deeds do follow them. God is our refuge and our strength, a very present help in times of trouble. The Lord says, do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. For I was dead, and now I'm alive forevermore. We brought nothing into this world, and surely we cannot take anything out of the world. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Can you back up first, please? Let's go some more. Give him some space.
Seeing that the earthly life of our sister has come to an end, we now commit her body to the ground. Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, and dust to dust, and leave her soul with God, her creator and maker. In sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord, who died, was buried, and was raised again for us. To him be glory forever and ever. Amen. O Lord, our God, you have promised to be with us in all circumstances of life, in life, in death, in struggles. We thank you that you have brought your daughter through life and has endowed her with gifts and talents which she has used to enrich the world in which she lived. And now, God, we leave her to you in Jesus' name.
In our adoration.
There are some courses listed at the back of our order of service, or the page close to the back, starting with No Grave Can Hold My Body Down, and we'll continue singing until we have exhausted them.
And the Yeah.
a grand time up in heaven. Have a grand time walking with the angels. Sing glory, hallelujah. We shall have a grand time up in heaven. Have a grand time. If you don't hear from me, don't come knocking at my door. I'll be gone in a twinkling of an eye, not far away. Oh, when my Lord shall call me home, I'll be happy on the under sky. Meet me by the river someday, by the river, not far away.
One who worked and lived and journeyed in our midst. Bodies are lowered. Coffins are covered, but the spirit soars towards God. Norma Elaine Graham, born March 1, 1945, died October 3, 2019, 74 years old. We remember her as a caring, kind, compassionate prophet and discerner who lived and gave her life so well. Depart out of this world, O Christian soul, in the name of God the Father Almighty who created you, in the name of Jesus Christ who redeemed you, in the name of the Holy Spirit who sanctifies you. May your rest this day be in peace and your dwelling in the paradise of God. Sleep well, Sister Norma, and God bless you. Amen. Have a good afternoon, everybody, and carry the torch for God wherever you go.
In a moment, in a twinkling of